Welcome to the Suraj Israni Center for Cinematic Arts. I'm really excited to have you all here for our second inaugural memorial lecture. My name is Michael Trigilio, and I'm the director of the Suraj Israni Center for Cinematic Arts. I'm a professor in the visual arts department here at UCSD, and I teach in film and video and media production, and many of our students are here today. If you're a student here, I see some of you are students. Thank you for coming on a Saturday, holiday weekend, week one of the quarter. Those of you who are not enrolled in class are like, what's a quarter? Well, it's just they've had their first week of classes, and they came to hear this great talk from our brilliant visitor. So I'm really grateful to the students for coming and checking this out. The Center for Cinematic Arts, the Suraj Israni Center for Cinematic Arts, is really dedicated to creating a center that serves students, faculty, staff, and the community in their love of cinema, of the movies, of media arts, however we may define that. And that includes filmmakers and people doing the work of shooting and editing and producing films, but also film scholars, people who are interested in the study of films, films from other parts of the world, films from various genres or historical films, or films from unusual places. And the way that we do that is with things like lectures and screenings, but also by supporting our students, our faculty and staff with fellowships. To support directly their research, their filmmaking. So the Suraj Israni fellowships that we've been doing the past year, we take applicants from our undergraduates, our graduate students, faculty, and our staff, and we are able to award some budget and some support to make, with equipment and other materials, for them to make their work, whether that's to travel to an archive or to make films or to use a specialized camera that we have at the center. We also recently proposed a new cinematic arts major, which is being decided by the campus now, but we're very hopeful about it. So a degree in cinematic arts is coming. Those of you who are currently students are like, I don't know if it's gonna apply to you because you might be graduating this year. So I'm telling you this, you're gonna be mad at me. You know, I hate it when I begin a lecture and someone's mad at me already, you know. But it will be something that I think in the next couple of years will come online and be very exciting for students. And we're planning on doing a series of master classes and workshops over the next year to bring together students and also community members from San Diego to think about how do they connect with one another across the dimensions of film and film scholarship and production, but also how do they widen their network from just campus to the broader South San Diego and San Diego region. So these are some of the things that we're working on. I want to do a quick introduction of our speaker and tell you a little bit about what we'll be doing today. I'm pulling up my notes, which is why I switched the screen. Today we are really honored to have Sara Dosa with us to present for the second inaugural Suraj Israni Memorial Lecture. Sara Dosa is an Oscar-nominated nonfiction filmmaker whose work centers on the human relationship with non-human nature. The films she's directed have won a Peabody, a Directors Guild of America Award, among others, and has been nominated for an Academy Award, BAFTA, and Independent Spirit Award. Her work's been shown at festivals around the world, including Sundance, South by Southwest, New Directors, New Films, and many, many more. She's screened works in partnership with museums, like MoMA, the Academy Museum, BAM PFA, and the Louvre. You've heard of the Louvre. That's a pretty great place to screen your film. Most recently, Sara has directed the Academy Award-nominated film Fire of Love, which premiered at the opening night of Sundance 2022, where it won the editing award and was immediately acquired by National Geographic Films. If you haven't seen Fire of Love, check it out as soon as you can. It is it's on National Geographic, which is on Disney Plus, and it's also on Hulu. None of them are paying me to say that. But that's how you can find it. And so you can enjoy this lovely film. It was released theatrically in 2022 and went on to be nominated for over 40 awards worldwide, winning the DGA Outstanding Direction in Documentary Film Award and the Critics' Choice Award for Best Archival Documentary, IDA's Best Writing and Best Cinematography, Cinema Eye Honors for Best Score, Best Editing, Best Visual Design, among others. among directing this film. She's directed and worked on many other films that have screened and seen considerable success. She was nominated for an Indie Spirited Award for The Last Season and the 2019 Golden Gate Award winning film, The Seer and the Unseen, her film from 2019. In 2018, Dosa was named to the inaugural class of Doc NYC's 40 Under 40 and was also inducted into the Academy of Motion Pictures Documentary Branch. So I would like to encourage you all to join me in welcoming Sara Dosa. Now, the program tonight will be Sara speaking, and then immediately thereafter, she's going to be joined on stage by one of my colleagues, Lorena Mostajo, who will be engaging Sara in a one-on-one conversation about Sara's work. A little bit about Lorena, just so you know and you have a little bit of context. Lorena Mostajo is an artist whose photographic practice spans Mexico and the United States and Bolivia. She's working on projects centered on the ways in which vernacular and historical photographs, national imaginaries, global and local economies, and tourism intersect. Her practice also includes written work. She's the founder of Taller California, Taller in Spanish means workshop. So Taller California, a small press of artists, writers, and community members from the Tijuana, San Diego area. The books are collaborative, and the press fosters experimental ways of production and distribution. Originally from Mexico City, Lorena completed her MFA in photography at the School of the Art Institute of Chicago, and her BA in Hispanic American Literature at the National Autonomous University in Mexico. Her work has been presented around the world, and I'm really excited to have her here. So we're going to give her a welcome now. And Sara, if you'll join me up here, we'll have Sara present some of her work. Thank you all for coming so far, and we'll enjoy Sara's talk. So this is this.
Thank you so much, Michael, Lorena, Tara, the entire Suraj Israni Center for Cinematic Arts, including the Israni family, for making this possible. I also want to thank my main collaborator, genius producer, who's my partner in all things, Shane Boris, who's sitting right here in the front row. I feel so grateful to speak about my work, as I'm truly in love with the process of making nonfiction films. It did not come easy, and it's still replete with challenges, but I believe I have my dream job, and it's a joy to share a bit about my process with you all today. One of my favorite writers, Rebecca Solnit, in The Far Away Nearby writes, "Stories are compasses. We navigate by them. To be without a story is to be lost in the vastness of a world that spreads out in all directions like Arctic tundra or sea ice. Stories are geography." Solnit's sentiment resonates deeply with me and articulates why I am driven to be a documentary filmmaker. I have a deep-seated desire to seek out and make meaning out of the absurd, the devastating, and the bleak. Stories are pathways to that meaning. Hearing stories and crafting them, or dwelling inside of the universe of a story, is akin to map-making for me. Piecing together stories allows me to draw connections between the seemingly unexplainable. It's how I find my way through the messiness and mysteries of the world, allowing me to grasp at understanding. Solnit's use of landscape metaphors of tundra and ice also speak to me, as I grew up with a love of nature. Raised in Northern California, among redwoods and wild oceans, I delighted in bird watching, mushroom hunting, and spotting insects and slugs on the forest floor. Being outdoors conjured a feeling of peace and awe, a realization that I am a part of an ever-expanding ecology, a kinship of life. Being in nature also taught me to see, and moreover, to look for connections between elements in nature, thus glimpsing at this kinship of life. I felt a profound sense of meaning in discovering the symbiotic relationship between the roots of mushrooms and that of pines, the courtship between bees and flowers, how deer and elk trails can catalyze the growth of fruit trees. These moments of glimpsing at the invisible threads, and through listening to nature and those who held a deep knowledge of nature, felt like revelations to me. This feeling and way of seeing informs how I approach my filmmaking, not just in terms of the subject matter I choose about the human relationship with non-human nature, but also in my storytelling style. Well, the connections between, say, war and mushroom hunting, or invisible elves and financial markets, which comprise my first two films, may not be immediately apparent, I delight in weaving together these unlikely pairs of themes, looking for how they resonate with each other in subtle yet powerful ways. In doing so, it is my hope that my work can contribute story, sound, and imagery that illustrates how humans are deeply, often unexpectedly interconnected to each other and to nature in an attempt to heal the false dichotomy of the nature and human divide. This is a theme that courses through my three independent feature-length films and guides my current projects. However, my approach has evolved since the making of my first film, entitled The Last Season, which was shot in 2011 and distributed in 2014. I'm going to show a little clip, which is the first 3.5 minutes of the film. So I will cue that up.
Nice one. Smell good. I like the morning smell. Yep.
In this introductory scene, our intention was to introduce our protagonist, a mushroom hunter named Koilok, who you just saw right there, and his journey. Not only is he searching for mushrooms to make a living, but he's looking for a family. While he doesn't call himself a lonely guy, one can assume that he's projecting when he says that the mushroom and that the mushroom should have a companion. Through the film, we learn that Khoi experienced horrific loss during the Khmer Rouge's genocide in Cambodia, but he finds a new life and livelihood in Oregon's wild mushroom harvest, and also a new family. As Khoi unearths mushrooms, his own past too becomes unearthed, and leads him to connect with Roger Higgins, who suffered his own trauma as a sniper in the US Army during Vietnam. Roger and Khoi become close friends, and eventually Roger adopts Khoi as his son. The Matsutake mushroom, the mushroom that you see in this clip, a fungus that grows in pairs and forms a symbiotic relationship with the roots of pine trees, is a metaphor for the unseen relationships between Khoi and his newfound family, as well as the interrelated conflicts of the Khmer Rouge and the Vietnam War. This is a metaphor that is developed throughout the film and the life cycle of the matsutake mushroom. And the life cycle of the matsutake mushroom was the narrative axis on which the film turned. However, the last season was my first film, and I admittedly have a very hard time watching it, even right now, without nitpicking it to shreds. I can't bear to see the shaky camera work, to see the lavalier mic that you can see on Khoi's vest. There's all kinds of sound issues, and the list goes on. But as I continued to learn about filmmaking and became inspired by filmmakers who I deeply admired, I began to further develop my own approach, as well as my philosophical inspirations and influences with regards to representations of nature. My second feature documentary, The Seer and the Unseen, is a fable about invisible elves, financial collapse, and the surprising power of belief, told through the story of an Icelandic grandmother named Raka Jonsdottir, who speaks on behalf of nature under threat. As it's about to be razed by a road construction project, Raka fights to save a threatened lava field believed to be home to a community of elves, invisible spirits of nature that over half of Iceland believes in. And this is actually a belief very commonly held around the world. The road is a needless and redundant project, a resuscitation of the country's dogmatic embrace of the invisible hand of the free market, which drove Iceland to its spectacular 2008 financial meltdown. Through Raka's story, this film explores the invisible forces, be they elves or capitalism, that shape our visible worlds and transform our natural landscapes. Rather than show a clip, I thought I'd show the trailer to give you kind of an overview of that film to see how these themes are woven a bit together. So I'll cue that one up.
It really feels like the elves have been preparing me for something, because the humans seem not to hear them very well. They were saying, this area cannot be destroyed. This cannot be destroyed.
Rather than illustrate nature in a somewhat instrumentalized metaphor, like in the last season, I was curious to play more allegorically in my second film, The Seer and the Unseen, and specifically to explore what a magic realist documentary could look like. We thought that drawing upon magic realism, an aesthetic movement that is quite prevalent in Icelandic storytelling, would be an effective means to showcase the aliveness and the sentience of nature, but also to situate the film in Raka's perspective. Raka, as a seer, is her world is one where elves are real, where rocks have life force, and the kinship of all life is fully visible. By employing tropes of magic realism, from our depiction of Raka's character, to our cinematography, to our sound design, we hoped to cast nature as participatory and agentive in collaboration with humans, rather than a backdrop or a symbol for them. Representations of nature as sentient and alive most forcefully can be seen in my last film, Fire of Love, which tells the story of French scientists Katia and Maurice Kraft, who fell in love over their shared passion for volcanoes. They dedicated their lives to documenting eruptions, creating a spectacular archive of volcanoes, and tragically died together in a pyroclastic surge at Japan's Mount Unzen in 1991. We used their incredible archive to tell a love triangle story between Katia, Maurice, and volcanoes. I'm going to show a brief clip so you can get a sense of their stunning cinematography and photography. This clip comes about 20 minutes into the film and is just a music-driven one, but I'll give you a sense of their love.
Je ne savais pas pourquoi je vivais. Je ne savais pas en quoi je servais. Maintenant, je le sais. Mes yeux ne sont faits que pour te regarder. Mes lèvres ne servent qu'à t'offrir mes baisers, mon oreille à compter les battements de ton cœur, et mes mains à saisir et garder ta chaleur. Et depuis lors, je me sens vivre.
So as you can see, my work is quite different from film to film, but there are certain themes that course through. In terms of this film, In Fire of Love, Katia and Maurice Kraft were utterly in love with volcanoes, and this was a mythic kind of love, where they understood volcanoes as a nearly supernatural force. Volcanoes possessed the power to create and to destroy. They contained an intelligence wholly their own that escaped human understanding. They could not be easily categorized in scientific terms. They were a profound mystery. Playing in tropes of magic realism and myth through our editing, narration, and sound design helped to articulate this rebellious transcendence and aliveness of the Earth. We did so to reflect Maurice and Katia's own perceptions and descriptions of the planet, but also as a means to counteract dangerous narratives that cast nature as separate from humans, and thus a resource to plunder, a wasteland to develop. I firmly believe that rendering the life force visible through the visual medium that is cinema can be an act of defiance against such representations. It is my hope that showcasing the sentience of nature can work to rewrite these damaging narratives and begin to restore respect for the power of the earth. As I said at the beginning, quoting Rebecca Solnit, stories are compasses, we navigate by them. I hope that my work can engage with other stories and films that seek to redraw maps that instead track relationships of symbiosis and reciprocity, of mushroom and pine tree, of nature spirits and lava, that make visible the relationships that connect us as humans as well as entangle us in nature. And thus, in some small way, I hope it can celebrate the kinship of life. Okay.
It is a pleasure to have a conversation with Sara, to share for her to share her knowledge and passion for film with the students, with the UCSD community, and all visitors from San Diego. And I hope somebody from Tijuana is here too. So I want to open the conversation with Fire of Love. For those of you who haven't seen the film, this is an urgent call to go and watch the film. As you saw on the screen, the images are incredibly compelling. And so one of the things that, you know, when I watched Fire of Love, not only I was taken aback by the masterful editing, the rhythm of the film, the craft of the film, the way in which you're assembling this incredible archive footage. But all, not only I was taken aback by that, but also in the ways you're asking the us, the viewers, to engage with this very sometimes mysterious, sometimes difficult to understand relationship between the human nature and non-human nature. And so, you know, I think using the language of moving images, it creates, there's a lot of power in bringing viewers to these very emotional spaces where this connection to something that seems abstract can have a different life, can take us to different ideas, emotions. So I was, you know, it would be great to hear from you what's behind this desire to explore this relationship. What kind of background, ideas, commitments you have to explore this theme?
Yeah. Oh, thank you for that beautiful question and for being in conversation right now. In Making Fire of Love, my team and I, and Shane, who's sitting in the front row, he's the producer and one of the writers on the film, so he deserves lots of credit as well. But we were absolutely floored by the spectacular imagery, and we wanted to start with that. Katya Maurice Kraft died 30 years ago, and unlike my past two films, where the subjects in the film, I developed very close relationships with them and could ask them questions, we couldn't ask Maurice and Katya any kinds of questions. So we had to seek other ways of figuring out how to get answers. However, we realized that there was perhaps a more profound beauty in the questions than actually finding answers. And that resonated with many of the themes that we began to realize were in the film. There's the theme of love, which many people might say is the greatest mystery of all, as well as the undefiable or undefinable kind of the way volcanoes seem to defy categorization in science. There's kind of a paradox in terms of scientific inquiry where the more you learn, the more you seek to discover, the more you realize you could never fully understand. And that was something that Katya and Maurice Kraft encountered in their own work as volcanologists as they attempted to document volcanoes. And it was something that we too, as filmmakers, began to discover. The more archive we tried to acquire, to listen to seek out, and to edit with, the more we realized these characters themselves were elusive. That taught us myriad things, but it also gave us an appreciation for the cinematic form in terms of trying to create spaciousness in the imagery, spaciousness in the editing itself. And when you're dealing with a scale as grandiose as volcanoes, luckily we had that at our disposal. So these were various things that kind of guided, I would say, the beginning of our process in trying to weave in how to depict this force that cannot be contained, and I believe that also can resonate with these wider themes about kind of the grandiosity, the majesty of nature, in general.
Tell us a little bit about your background. You started to be a filmmaker, and because we have many students here who are always asking, how do I start, you know, in film? How do I make a project? So please tell us a little bit about, you know, that road and also how learning how to make, you mentioned, you know, watching the first film was hard, but, you know, so how craft and ideas and the ethics of filmmaking and the topics that you're interested were weaved for you?
Yeah, I actually didn't, I took some film classes when I was an undergraduate, but I thought I was going to be a professor of cultural anthropology for most of my life. My mother, she's now retired, but she was a professor of anthropology, and I loved studying anthropology. My focus was on critical theory and kind of the anthropology of economy, and I was just utterly fascinated by how humans made meaning through through relationships with nature, but also how relationships of economy ordered the world in many ways. And I'm going to stop myself before I go on a tangent. But I was, fascinated with the paradigms and the questions that anthropology taught me, but I became quite frustrated as I started to embark down a path of academia myself. And I became more drawn to art and to filmmaking. Most notably, I saw a film, actually, I was in a Students for Economic Justice group, and we watched a documentary that was about free trade in Jamaica, and I remember being powerfully blown away by this film. I felt like the kind of paradigms of economics that I was interested in from an academic perspective were so beautifully and powerfully put in such human terms. And kind of from that moment, I started thinking maybe filmmaking, and specifically documentary filmmaking, could be a way to explore these ideas, but in a way that could engage with communities and through the power of story. I'll spare you the very circuitous journey, but I went from being an intern to then an assistant, then a coordinator to an associate producer to a producer, and always dreaming of being a director. But it was very hard to get initial funding for the films I wanted to make. And my first film, The Last Season, actually was inspired by a lecture I heard during graduate school when I was studying anthropology. So I would work on that and nights and weekends and try to apply for any grant possible. And while I had my day job working these other jobs, largely in producing and in film. So I feel profoundly grateful that I now get to be able to work as a director, especially knowing the difficult climate it took to get there originally.
This aspect that you mentioned, the economical aspect, and how not only the economical, but the political, for example, we see in Fire of Love, how there's at the beginning of the film, we learn about Claudia Maurice, that they participated in May 68, and there's this also a disappointment about humanity. And so I find that in the three films that you've made, there's a connection between economical forces, political forces, and they're weave really like kind of subtly, but sometimes really strongly with what's their relationship with these characters with nature. So could you explain a little bit more about, you know, how you thought about these characters building their narrative vis-a-vis what they were living? And I'm asking this question because it tends, sometimes maybe people could interpret, well, this was the context that they were living, but I feel that in Fire of Love, it goes beyond the context. It's something that really defined even their relationship to volcanoes.
Yeah, that's a great question. And yes, you're right. And in Fire of Love, for those of you who haven't seen it, Katia and Maurice Kraft, they were coming of age in France in the late 60s. And they were horrified by the images they were seeing from the Vietnam War and participated in student movements. They were part of the student communist group for a moment. However, they became very disillusioned with the movement itself, seeing infighting in the student group. And due to their love of nature, in those young years of theirs, they kind of saw a more, in their words, an authentic expression of power in the natural world than what they called human power, which they said was vain and absurd. They felt like humans were destroying everything that they created, whereas in nature, they felt like they could really see the act of creation. As they grew older and the more time they spent with volcanoes, that paradigm shifted because they also saw the destructive elements of volcanoes and they matured. However, that idealism and that quest for an expression of power that wasn't predicated on violence was something that stayed very true to them. And that was something, too, that we really kind of wanted to infuse into the film, what was this reverence for the power of the earth. And to, as I mentioned in my talk, to kind of center the sentience, to showcase that the earth has intelligence, it has ontology, it has an expression that is way beyond human understanding. And by doing so is kind of an act of politics too, because there are these dominant discourses of nature, you know, as a resource to be exploited, et cetera, that goes back hundreds and hundreds of years. And so all to say, it felt like a subtle act of politics for us to be illustrating volcanoes in a narrative that was in line with this view of not just Katia and Maurice, but something that we believed in ourselves.
And another aspect of Fire of Love that we saw in this clip, there's a moment where the music stops and then we kind of breathe when the person is walking. I think it's Katia is walking on top of the lava, and then we cut to the ocean and then the music goes back. So there's a lot of playfulness and rhythm in how the film is crafted and edited. And also the way they film, you know, the archive is incredible. There's I feel that, and I listened to an interview where you mentioned this relationship to the new wave. So in terms of, you know, assembling the film, talking to your editors, how were you thinking to recover, like, wink at this, you know, this kind of aesthetic of the time?
Yeah, that's a great question. First, I worked with phenomenal editors. My editors, Aaron Casper and Jocelyn Chapu, are brilliant and hilarious, and I'm forever grateful for them. The archive itself, what Katya and Marie shot, it's extraordinary, but it was also, like many archives, it came to us extremely disorganized. It didn't have sound. The 200 hours that they shot was shot with no sync sound, so for us it was silent. Many of the shots were like 2 seconds long, maybe 7 seconds long, so it was very difficult material to actually work with. This meant that we had to invent theories of how we were actually going to put together the film, because we of course needed to, otherwise it just would be kind of volcano soup. So we decided to figure out how to do that, and for us, we thought, well, we should start with Katya and Maurice themselves. Let's listen to them however we can, even though, you know, they passed on. Let's watch every piece of footage, let's listen to their interviews, let's interview their friends and loved ones who are still with us to see what drove them, what really influenced their style and cinematography. And we learned that they were quite influenced by the French New Wave, which again was the kind of aesthetic movement that was very popular in France in the late 60s and 70s and spread out around the world. Some of the French New Wave elements can be seen especially in Maurice's cinematography. He was the main cinematographer. In the film, there are these really fun kind of snap zooms and playful pans that a lot of people today would associate with Wes Anderson, but was very much kind of first rooted in the French New Wave. So that shows up in the film, and that's something we decided to embrace. Katya was the author of the nearly 20 books that they wrote. And there's this very playful, kind of bombastic voice that she writes with, and that informed the narration that we ended up having to adopt. Again, there's no sound, and so we thought that narration could be a tool that we would embrace to tell this love triangle story. And so that's also kind of a hallmark style of the French New Wave, is having kind of a subjective and playful narrator. So all to say, listening to them helped us to develop the tools that we would use in terms of editing the film itself. But those interruptions that you mentioned, that you saw in that clip, that was also something that came from the French New Wave, but also resonated with some of the themes of time that were very important to us. We kind of juxtapose geologic time, which plays out in eons, you know, millennia, against the kind of the precarity and fleeting nature of a human life. And a lot of what we tried to do in the film is have these moments of interruption, where it was kind of like the Earth was interrupting humans to playfully poke at the forces that kind of rage and shift beneath our feet every day. So that's my very long way of saying there's a lot of different influences, but we had a very fun time kind of crafting what would be the kind of armature, the theoretical framing of how we actually approached the edit of this very difficult, though beautiful, imagery itself.
And I think that, you know, the way you assemble the film, the way it's crafted, it also mimics the time. There's the geological time and the observational time that they have too, because we saw also on screen the hand that moves and kind of touches the rock, the lava. So there's a fascination that they also have for looking at themselves, you know, looking at the recordings and looking at themselves, looking at volcanoes. So I feel that for those of you who have watched the film, kind of as viewers, we also kind of jump into that trance of being fascinated by that. You know, I found myself thinking about, you know, the first time I heard an earthquake. I was in elementary school, and a friend of mine said, I grew up in Mexico City, so it's a city of earthquakes. So someone said, just put your ear on the ground. And as a child, you know, that was incredible. And so I just kept thinking about this relationship of a force that you want to understand, you want to get close to. And I think that, you know, the rhythm of the film asks the viewers to do that too.
Oh, thank you for that. Kachi and Maurice were so in love with volcanoes, and after seeing hundreds of hours of volcano footage, I certainly don't blame them. But that love, it coursed through everything. I feel like you can sense it from behind the camera, and you see it in those shots. But they were trying so desperately to show their love to their audiences. I should say, for those of you who haven't seen the film, the crafts would tour around the world with their volcano footage and give lectures. And it was very much a mission of theirs to invite people to fall in love with the planet too. So all to say, they had audiences in mind, and they were trying desperately to figure out how to tell this. And one of the ways they did so was putting largely Katya in the frame for her to, whether it's lovingly petting hardened lava or running across a still molten lava field, their love was infectious. And so that was something that we felt so lucky that we got to play with. It was really our hope that if that spirit could be infused in our film, it could also have the hopeful side effect of inviting the audience to kind of find a way to fall in love with the landscape themselves. And like what you said, that intimacy of listening to the earth, there is like this cosmic connection that we can have. And of course, many people from around the world have had this for hundreds, thousands of years. But we're in this time of extreme catastrophe. And so finding a relationship of love, of caring, of empathy for the earth, I think extremely important in this moment.
I want to jump to this year and Unseen. Again, all of the films, you have to watch them after these. Please go and watch the films. One of the things that I was I was really moved. There's a scene in the film where, and let me know if I'm mispronouncing Rocca's name. She's there with a fellow environmentalist trying to defend these volcanic. Oh, and by the way, I don't remember. Reminds me of another question, but I'll do it. I'll ask in a second. So she's there. Protecting this place, and the police arrives, and they're resisting. And it's an incredible, moving moment in which, this is a character that, a person, sorry, I keep saying character, this is a person who's a seer, who has communication with elves, and a couple months earlier, she receives a message that she has to save this area. And so she protests with other people. The police arrives. They resist, and then they're taken to jail. And so there's a moment in which there's an incredibly, impotence. And I found that in the film a very strong moment. So could you talk about how you weave, for example, in this film, the relationship between the political and this way of the seer is connecting to the land?
Yeah, that's a great question. Yeah, in that moment, you're right. They're the protesters who are trying to protect this lava field that is believed to be home to a community of elves. It's also a very important ecological zone. In Iceland, it's a place where many endangered birds actually go to nest. So there was many reasons for this environmental group to show up to protect this lava field. And Rocca, our main person in the film, she was there, as she says, to represent she was there on behalf of the elves. In Iceland, as in many places around the world, the environmental movement is also very closely aligned with kind of leftist movements as well. And this was a time in Iceland when a more conservative party had ushered in these what some people might say quite extreme development plans to try to recover from the absolutely spectacular financial collapse. But that meant that places all around this extraordinarily wild and beautiful and ecologically diverse country were being destroyed. So the environmental politics were very much infused with the politics of the country overall. So all to say, this moment of kind of standing up against the police on behalf of elves had resonated in many different ways across Icelandic society. And that was actually how I first learned about the film. Was I read an article that said Elf Lobby shuts down road construction project. And I thought, I've never read that in a headline before. What does that mean? And once I dug deeper, I got to see that behind this kind of, it was meant to be kind of almost a gimmicky, kind of cutesy title, but there was a deep cultural history and a political movement behind this. And I won't give away what happens in the film, but that ended up catalyzing a lot of change for not just this lava field, but kind of the politics of development in the Reykjavik area as well.
Thank you. And the question that I wanted to ask that I thought while I was asking you this question is, when I watched the film, it starts with footage of a volcano. So I was like, oh, there's a connection here. So could you please, I think they're connected. So could you please tell us a little bit?
Thank you for bringing that up. Yeah, this year in the Unseen opens with archival imagery of erupting volcanoes in Iceland. And that's actually, that's how we learned about Fire of Love. We wanted to open up this year in this Unseen with imagery like that to kind of put in context that Iceland is a land in the making. It's geothermal, it feels very alive. Geologically, it's quite young. And we thought that archival imagery of erupting volcanoes could set that context quite beautifully. But once we did the search for that kind of imagery, we learned about this French couple that had taken just gorgeous imagery of volcanoes. And once we learned that they were a couple in love and that they were obsessed with the earth, we thought, oh wow, we want to learn more about them. And so we kind of filed that into the backs of our minds. Once we finished this year in the Unseen, we actually started making a different film about these mysterious methane explosions in the Yamal Peninsula in Siberia. However, right before we were about to do our first location scout, that's when COVID hit and the entire project unfortunately collapsed. And so we thought during lockdown, if we could get access to the archival imagery that the crafts took, that could be a way to continue to make work, you know, doing an archival film rather than having to go out and do any new production, since that wasn't allowed at the time. And luckily, we were able to access the archive, and through kind of a complicated remote setup, we were able to keep making work. But I love that you picked up on that, because they're very, very closely connected.
I just want to ask about your future projects. I know, could you tell us a little bit about what's in the making?
Sure. So I'm in early development on two new projects. And since they're in development, I'm quite clumsy about talking about them. But I'm really excited about each of them. One is a film that's about glaciers in Iceland, and the other one is about earthquakes in Mexico. So the glacier in Iceland one is a story of an Icelandic couple that actually also fell in love mapping Iceland's glaciers in the 1950s. But when we meet them in 2015, very sadly, one of them is losing his memory. He has Alzheimer's disease. And this is the same moment that Iceland has a glacier that is declared dead. It's the first Icelandic glacier that is declared dead. So the film will kind of pair his receding memory with Iceland's receding ice. And this will be narrated and told through their grandson, who is this celebrated, who's a brilliant poet named Andrésson Magnusson. So the film will kind of explore their love and be a meditation on time and systems of water at this moment of climate catastrophe, and what it means for Iceland to think about having no ice. So that's one film. The other project is about earthquakes in Mexico, which I mentioned, and we'll look at the echoes between the three earthquakes that have all happened on September 19th. For those of you who don't know, Mexico City has experienced three major earthquakes since September 19th, 1985, September 19th, 2017, and September 19th, 2021. And for earthquakes, something that plays out in geologic time, for these all to have that coincidence to happen on a human calendar is profound and baffling, and there's myriad stories that people tell to explain this. We're really interested in hearing those stories, especially in how they can resonate and have dovetailed with stories about the colonial violence that happened in Mexico City in the 1500s. It's in very early stages, but we're imagining the film could be a kind of a time travel film of sorts, and how earthquakes don't just open up space, but also ruptures in time. And so we're interested in seeing how how that could happen. We don't know how we're going to do that yet. So I'm really excited to go down this development process. And I'm also really excited because we're collaborating with two of Lorena's friends in Mexico City on the project. So it'll be really fun to get to spend a lot of time there.
I can't wait to watch the film, also because I lived through the, you know, two of those earthquakes. So, and I have to say, I lived through those earthquakes, and there's an active volcano, the Popocatépetl, that is very close to Mexico City. So all your films have, you know, kind of ignited all these, my relationships to these forces that I grew up with, and they're constantly there. So yeah, I can't wait. So I have many questions to ask Sara, but I won't be, you know, like, let me ask you more questions. So I want to open up the Q&A for the audience. So there's a microphone there.
I wanted to ask your advice. A friend of mine, he's a pretty famous film composer, he does film scoring and he was composing, you know, orchestra director. And he told me he'd like me to manage his production about himself. And I have some experience, you know, working behind the scenes and writing and so forth. But I was wondering if you could give me any advice on how to go and manage a documentary about a composer. And would it be like going through the archives or would it be like new stuff? I'm really kind of, I'm wondering if I'm getting in over my head because I agreed to manage the production.
That's a great question. So, a film about the composer?
Yeah, about my friend, about a film, not a documentary about himself.
Yeah.
Even film scores and even some of the work.
Yeah, there's so many different ways you could go about it. My best advice would be to listen to the nuances of his particular style. You know, if he has a particular love for, whatever makes his music unique and singularly his. Let that guide you. In Fire of Love, Katia and Maurice were very into the French New Wave, and so therefore we decided to let that guide our own directorial choices. So I just offer that as a suggestion when making a portrait to, you know, feel as much like him as possible. And I feel like music documentaries are, in my opinion, just particularly fun because you get to be so playful. Using music as a guide can allow you to do all kinds of exciting editing choices to just kind of, it sounds perhaps cheesy, but I really believe it, to follow your gut, you know? Sometimes when I don't know how to edit something, I'll just put on a piece of music and just like let the rhythms of that song guide the choices that I make. And so if you're working with his music, I recommend starting with that, if that's helpful. But if he does have archives, if there's any imagery or interviews, sound, whatever archives you could get, that's always a great place to start.
When you were mixing your documentary, did you organize it like a writer does an outline and a treatment for a novel? Is it like similar for a documentary?
It's different every project. For the last season and this year and the unseen, those were observational films or verite films. That meant that we were really following kind of life as it was unfolding. And we had a sense of where things might go and a sense of the ideas that we wanted to put in relationship with each other. But we never knew what was going to happen. And so we had to be open to the serendipity of life in the world. However, with Fire of Love, since it was almost exclusively archival film, and Maurice and Katia had passed away, we had to construct it from the beginning in a much different way. And so Shane and I actually ended up writing a very detailed outline for the film before we began editing, and we used that outline to guide our process. Once we began editing it and putting it all together, we realized that a lot of the outline didn't hold up on screen. It worked on paper, but not once you got the imagery up and running, and so we had to then rewrite it again. But that was a much more constructed process since we already had the pieces laid out for us, if that makes sense.
Thank you for being here and for talking about your work. It was just riveting, and the examples that you shared, I didn't want them to end. I just wanted them to go on. But I wonder if there are other directors who have inspired your work.
Oh, that's a great question. There's so many directors who have inspired my work, and writers and musicians too. One of my favorite directors is actually is a French filmmaker named Chris Marker, who Lorena has written a book about. So I'm edited a book about. She's an expert on him. So it was particularly fun to get to be in conversation with her about that. He was part of the French New Wave. Has a singular voice within that. But my favorite film of all time is a film called Sans Soleil, which is just a beautiful, poetic collage film. It's kind of a travelogue across time and space. It's hard for me to ever define, but all to say, his work deeply inspired me. There's so many other filmmakers. There's a filmmaker named Miranda July, who she actually was our narrator for Fire of Love. She makes narrative films, scripted films, that are largely about kind of the kind of strange beauty of what it means to be alive. Her work inspires me deeply. Patricio Guzman is a Chilean filmmaker whose work I love in particular. He has a film called Nostalgia for the Light, which is a gorgeous and heartbreaking kind of meditation on Chilean history. It takes place on the Atacama Desert in Chile, where there's this extraordinary observatory that, you know, where you gaze up into the heavens, but he asks this question about the bodies that lay buried underneath during Pinochet's reign in Chile. So I could really go on and on, but I'll just leave it at those three who've really inspired my work.
Hi, thank you so much for this wonderful talk. I want to ask a question because I'm interested in your academic background before you step into filmmaking. Can you share maybe a concept or term that you've learned from cultural anthropology or film class that give you a great impact that can lead, can guide you throughout? Because I am teaching my students theoretical works and they were not interested at all. Of course, because that's sometimes they were written in a very abstract way, but I want to ask your vision in that and how some of the theoretical work impacted your filmmaking. Thank you.
Sure. Oh, that's a really good question. I'm going to spend a lot of time actually thinking about that. But I'll do my best attempt to answer it in the moment. When I was more situated in academia, I was primarily studying economics and the politics of development. However, my kind of my curiosity and love of critical theory and anthropology and sociology has remained, even though I only am able to like read some books here and there, as opposed to studying it intensely like I used to. And I would say, in terms of a phrase or a academic word, I think the one that comes to mind is entanglements. There's kind of a school of thought if you're familiar with the work of anthropologist Anna Singh, who she actually inspired the last season. She has written just incredible works, and The Mushroom at the End of the World is the book that I was actually her research assistant as she was writing that book, and that's what led to making the last season. But she, along with Donna Haraway, and there's kind of a set, especially of feminist anthropologists, who write about kind of the entanglements of all life forces and breaking down this, this, as I kind of mentioned in my talk, the dichotomy between this understanding of human exceptionalism and bounded individualism, to instead posit a theory of life where we are all the ecology. And I feel like cinema can be a particularly exciting format to play in, because you can show those entanglements, you can show those relationships so visually, you can hear them. There's all kinds of things you can do to play with time and presence. I would just offer that as a suggestion, if that's of interest or at all resonates with the kind of work that you're looking for. It's one that has very much inspired me.
Thank you so much for being here today. That's my first question. May you just provide some tangible solutions to socioeconomic issues when trying to produce authentic films like Fire of Life that may not be supported by the blockbuster genre that economically so important in our pop culture today?
That's another one I'm going to be thinking about for a very long time. the film industry, like so many industries, is mired in deeply inequitable politics. Access is extremely limited, especially for women and people of color. So creating and catalyzing meaningful change that can create that kind of equity is absolutely essential. It's really hard to do, and right now I feel like there's people who are working on it, but there's also a lot of performance that feels almost more infuriating than like actual progress. First, I think it's about talking about it, so thank you for bringing up that question, because now there's a room full of people who are getting to hear about it, so I really appreciate that. But I do think that there's something that people can do on their own film teams. I feel really lucky that on my teams, we tend to work in a very collaborative way. We try to have as much equity across the board as possible. I primarily do work with women. I feel really lucky that I've had some phenomenal male allies. But a lot of why I actually work with women is because I've experienced just horrific sexism. I'm going to try and cut myself off because I could really talk for a while about that. But I do think that from kind of your own film teams and how you build your teams, how you listen and how you collaborate with people is absolutely essential. And having the conversations, challenging people to open up their funding sources or advocating for more just distribution opportunities is absolutely essential. And it's really, really hard to do. But I think it starts with finding your people, finding your allies, and making work, too, that reflects your own values.
All of the source material you talk about in your films are all fascinating stories that maybe you wouldn't have heard about otherwise. And I'm just wondering, how do you pick what exactly draws you to these particular stories? And also, you mentioned you're from Northern California. Like, you've done so many things around the world. Would you ever do something, a film closer to home, possibly?
Yeah, these are all such great questions. Thanks, everybody. In terms of the source material, the stories that I think interest me most, again, I think kind of live in this kind of nature, non-human nature relationship world. But there's something I honestly that I just kind of feel. It's like when I'll like read an article or I'll hear an idea or hear someone share a story and I just like get this feeling, and I just become obsessed. I feel bad, like Shane knows this very well, I kind of won't stop talking about the thing or thinking about the story. And then it's a matter of just testing it out and really being interrogative to figure out like, should this be a film? Or is this best as an essay? You know, figuring out why cinema is the right medium for this is super important. But it's really, it's listening to that feeling of like, I just have to do this and nothing's gonna stop me, even if it's going to take me 7 years, and I'm doing it on nights and weekends while I have like 3 other day jobs. So, and in terms of Northern California, I would love to make a film there. There's definitely some ideas I've had and kind of explored around there. These other ones kind of came up, and there was a timeliness to them that kind of carried me away, but I'm absolutely always excited to explore stories that are very close to home, too.
I wanted to ask you about form. I find something very interesting about your films is that they're all very different in the way you approach the subject matter. And we live in a moment where we're watching a lot of documentaries. There's a lot of cookie-cutter ways of approaching subjects, and there's something very creative and intimate in each way you approach the storytelling process in each of the films. So I'd be curious to know how you think about that.
Yeah, I think in terms of form, it's again thinking about the themes in the film and trying to listen deeply to how the people in the film see the world and trying to create a form that is reflective of that. For Seer and the Unseen, Raka, our seer, she literally sees the world in a way that most people would say is magical. And since magic realism is an aesthetic movement that is very strong in Iceland, we thought, okay, let's see if we can make a documentary that is infused with magic realism. And at first that seemed almost like an oxymoron to us, because so many people think of documentary as like factual and kind of more of like reporting or news coverage, and that's not at all kind of this. I have respect for that style, but that's just not where my brain goes or my heart wants to go. So I'll just say it's really about finding the form by listening to the people and making sure that it's an accurate portrayal and a true portrayal. And again, I feel like fact is different from truth. And so it's about finding that essential truth. And like for Raqqa, magic realism felt like that form. In Fire of Love, since we were dealing with archival material, it was about trying to actually think about archives as a kind of sediment in a way, and thinking geologically the way the crafts would have. And so we tried to find kind of these resonant themes in how they would tell stories and how science is often narrated, but also how the crafts themselves as kind of these almost like science poet philosophers would think. And so that's what led to the various kind of styles too of our film. So it is always different, but I feel like there's something really exciting about that, to get to try to step into other perspectives with collaboration and deep listening to make sure we're not taking for granted or misinterpreting those, but it allows for kind of an expansiveness of form, even if there's thematic consistency across the work that I do.
Well, with that, I want to say thank you so much to Sara Dosa and Lorena Mostajo for their discussion.
Thank you, Lorena, and thank you, Michael, and thank you all for being here so much.